I need to make it down. It's going.
As it is, we have the council chamber. If the council wants to invest in the building, as officers, we'd be delighted to do that.
Sounds like the council couldn't do that, which would be called upon to the council.
It must be a project, and probably quite hard to do that. Those are the city hall and building council chamber. When you consider all the massive waste and billions in the last year, then we've been encouraging to build a nice city hall as well as our council chamber.
Members here wanted to suggest that to the council. These buildings are sold and there's a new city hall built, then obviously members are.
I think it's on the ground, we don't think so.
Sorry, Phil, when you come in, I had, sorry, I had Brian wants to come in, but put you on the list, Phil.
Thank you, Chair. My only problem with this discussion is that tonight's meeting is a meeting of the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee. So surely it's not our responsibility to have a debate and decide what to do about the problems we had last night or what to do in the future. So my question, leading on from that, Chair, is exactly where would we take the issues? I'm not saying we just bury the issues that have been raised tonight. No. I just don't think it's proper to this committee. And I don't know what exactly what committee should deal with it, but perhaps we should pass it on to them.
The reason, Chair, I ask the question is this is the committee it belongs to. Because webcasting, the running of meetings, public access and the constitution is this committee, which is why I answer the question. So I'm not strictly on this business, it's connected enough, because it was about the working of my team and the operation of last night. But you're quite right, you have to stay for the agenda.
Phil.
Forgive me. This isn't intended tongue-in-cheek. Well, it has an interesting side. We now own a cinema. What is the capacity of the seating area in the cinema that might allow members to be the public to be seated there and to see the council is in action on the floor of the cinema, as it were, if there was space for available?
The simple answer to that is that the council owns the freehold of a cinema that is leased out to a cinema provider. So if you cinemas wish to let us have it, no doubt they will hire it to us. We simply own the freehold, not the operation, not the leasehold. In the way that most commercial premises are held, they're held by leasehold. We do not hold the lease, and then we don't have occupation of the cinema.
Has anybody got any more questions for Jonathan or Judah? No? Okay, so the recommendation.
Before you go to the recommendation, this isn't a hair care at the outset. One of the last votes was to do this, but I take it, Jeff, that you're leaving the council.
Yes.
Okay, so could I put on a member of our council, Jeff, for the way he's done on our team? We haven't always seen that, have we? But we've always had difficulties, haven't we? There's always been a solution. So I'd like to call the record. I'll use thanks to Jeff for the way he's done.
Well, no, thanks very much, Chris. I'm sure that's something that we all echo. So wish you well in planning your next adventure, don't you?
When are you leaving, Captain Mayor?
Last day is the 22nd of March.
Not that you're counting or it's a great year.
That's 12 and a half working days.
Yes. Okay, so the recommendation then on page 181 is that the members' information and ICT acceptable use policy be recommended to council for approval. So are we all happy to agree that recommendation?
Yeah.
Great, thank you very much. And thank you very much, Jack. And Judith, thank you, Jacob.
Thank you.
Okay, so if we move back to the order on our agenda now, if we go back to item four then, please. Council procedural standing order concerning voting and electronic voting on pages 15 to 24. So who's taking us through the student level? Thank you. Thank you.
So we've taken away comments on your previous discussion. I won't take too much of your time by rehearsing that. Hopefully the recommended standard will just know that we see deals with those issues. You see the coloured changes, the additions are as it were, are slightly different.
That's slightly lighter.
Slightly lighter.
Is there anything anybody wants to ask about that? I know that we've haven't really known that actually. I have a question. Can I start with my question? So my question was around, is it covered in here? I did have a look through and I wondered if it was kind of buried in some legal terminology somewhere about when people are having a roll call vote and we are pressing the button as well as speaking. If there's a discrepancy, does it specifically say in here that it is a spoken vote that takes precedence?
Yes, Chair. It states in here, recording vote, and I know you use the phrase here, can't vote, but I'm trying to encourage you to use the same language everyone else does. So where there's a recorded vote, then it's from a roll call, and it's that vocal, formal vote that is recorded. It's actually silent here as to the last night, actually, you may wish to ask tonight as to what you found that confusing last night, asking people to say things and press a button, and actually, if you're going to. That was for the benefit of watchers and the screen to press the vote. We followed the process that is here, that the formal vote is what will take precedence. Actually, it's within your gift tonight, if you choose to do so, to recommend that it is simply the oral vote that's taken, and you don't confuse members by asking to press a button at the same time. So I had envisaged this model discussed tonight.
Councillor Stuart, I think you'd like to comment on this.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Not that members would be confused by pressing the buttons and saying the vote at the same time, but I think last night did confuse things. And also the technicality of whether members should be pressing the button before they are asked. So I think it would be reasonable that if we're going to suspend the vote, and in the sense of if the spoken vote is what counts, then I don't see the point in us using the buttons as well. So from that point of view, I think that when we do have a recorded vote, card vote, whatever you want to call it, then we don't use the buttons.
For people's views, Chris, and then
I've got Phil. Yeah, thanks, Chair. That would be what says, and I'm not going to disagree, but clearly last night there was a training need in a bunch of labour group.
Thank you for your comments.
I think because you're trying to do two things at once, I'm very good at coordinating myself, and doing things. There was a confusion in my mind as to whether I turn the microphone on and then press the button, which to do. I suspect that if that same time lag applies to a member 60 times 20 seconds, or whatever it might be, we could spend ages on it. So I think which is the most shortest and convenient way when a roll call is called for, and the answer is I think dispense with the electronics and speak your mind.
Any other views? I think if you ask for me, I was going to say it's actually three things you're doing, because you're kind of pressing the button to say what your vote is, pressing the microphone and to say, well, yeah, but also remembering which way
you're
going as well. So it's a bit Chris and Chris. So, Chris, wait, please.
Chair. A couple of things. Thanks, Vicky, for taking those changes into account. But if we look at page 41, 14.3, I don't think that if the standards panel consider that a Malthusian witness should give evidence, then the panel will be entitled to give such weight as it considers appropriate to give evidence given. I think it's missing out the part that says, I believe it should say the standards panel considers that a Malthusian witness should give evidence, and they have failed to attend, then the panel will be entitled to give such weight as it considers appropriate to give evidence given. I think it's missing out that little piece that says we only give that weight if the complainant doesn't attend the panel. Mm-hmm. And then we can determine, the panel can determine whether really not that interested or whether the evidence should have one weight. I just think something like that needs inserting. Mm-hmm. That's one thing. And the only other thing I've picked up is on large page 43, and this might be made because it's not to be had so many times. On review panel 17.1, it says the management officer seek to convene a meeting. I thought we'd taken out the word seek and agree the management officer shall convene a meeting with Shannon's appeal panel within 20 working days. I thought we'd taken that seek to out. Am I mistaken?
Chair, I think that was the one seek to that to leave in.
Okay.
On the basis that if for some reason it couldn't have been held, then it could be held to ransom and someone would say, well, then it's an improper process and it's all gone and done.
That was the one
left in for, so that you couldn't be held to ransom.
Okay, thank you. I'm happy to let that go.
Okay, no, thank you for that explanation. Christian.
Just to say thank you to Vicky really and the members of the ruling party. I think it's much clearer now with proper sort of how many days it's going to take. And I think it's much clearer for anybody. And I think, you know, it's very unpleasant to have any sort of complaint against you, but at least now is a proper timetable. So thank you very much for that.
Anybody else want to say anything? Thanks. It was a really good, I think, workshop. Thank you to everybody who came and took part on that. You know, we'd all done our homework, haven't we? Going through it. I like the fact that there's a flowchart as well, like an easy reference.
Yeah.
But as well as the detail as well. So thank you very much for your hard work on that. So the recommendations then that we're being asked to agree on, there's two of them on page 25. So to adopt the revised procedure for dealing with complaints made under the Members' Code of Conduct in accordance with the revised protocol document attached as Appendix A, and then B, that the revised protocol is made available on the Council website. So we have to agree those.
I think we have to agree those with those. The amendment, Vicky mentioned and the amendments I mentioned in my part of that. Not to seek to amend, but we talk about the witness.
Yes, yeah, when we talk about that.
Those two amendments, yes.
Yeah,
then
when
people
don't attend.
Yes, then I'm happy to propose that, Gerry.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Second. Oh, sorry, can I have a second, please? Thanks, Gerry. I'll even read that.
Yeah.
Fabulous. Okay. Right. And then we move on to agenda item 6. So local government ethical standards review by the Committee on Standards in Public Life that has been published. So if I hand over to you, Phil, on this, thank you.
So Chair, we can answer questions on this as well. As you saw, she put the report together.
Mm.
There are four aspects to this. The first is that the standards on the Committee on Standards in Public Life is otherwise known by people as the No-Limit Committee.
Mm.
We call it being known as that, so that's who it is.
Yeah.
They've taken a huge amount of evidence over some time. Every year they produce one large report. There hasn't been one about local government for several years, so this is it. They seek to set out a number of recommendations, and as you'll see, most of those recommendations accord to the response that this committee put forward, as you submitted evidence. Various parties put forward evidence, and actually a lot of the recommendations have come back have fallen very much in line with the comments that you made as a committee. Obviously, there's a great deal more in terms of the recommendations that they've made, most of which are to central government. And then they also captured what they considered to be best practice. So the job that we've done is compare what we do at the moment here to that best practice. So the comments from ourselves are firstly the main recommendation, which is that they have asked the Local Government Association to put together a revised member code of conduct. If you recall, there is currently a template produced by the Local Government Association. I know that because painfully I helped draft it and have said on record in other places that it's the one piece of legal work I did that I couldn't possibly recommend to anybody. And thus the outcome here is that the committee agrees that it's not the best thing since sliced bread. However, the Local Government Association have not been keen to take that forward, but we wait and see and do hope that they do coordinate something together. In the meantime, the recommendation that a code of conduct be reviewed actually is as applicable to each individual council, I think, as it is to the Local Government Association, including that element that says there should be some sort of common standard. Now, locally, two things for you to take into consideration. Firstly, is that there are some errors in Wirral's Code of Conduct. Because it was very much a lift and shift from the previous model, when it was moved across, there were little bits there. So there are, for example, some definitions that aren't carried over into your code. They don't quite make sense. They're only minor, but they are there. Secondly, is that in conversation preparing for this paper with colleagues across the Liverpool City region, was the conversation of, well, wouldn't it be helpful if there was a common code of conduct across the city region? And as it happens, there is in a way, because 2 years ago when the city region was established and the constitution was put together, a piece of work was undertaken to produce a code of conduct for the new combined authority. Again, I did that piece of work when I was in private practice on here, so I have to prepare that interest. But actually what I did was try and take the best bits of all of the six authorities and put it together into one common one, so that those members from each authority that went along to the combined authority would thus be wearing two hats, actually saw their own code reflected to some extent in that. So there is a common code of conduct that is there for you to look at and evaluate and consider whether or not you would wish to change to that. It's not that different. And my recommendation to you would be to request a report to come forward to you that lets you know all the other councils, all the other standards committees who are going. Plan is to have the same conversation, what they're saying, whether they're going to review their code of conduct, and then of course for you to compare for yourself what your current code of conduct is, the new code of conduct, and of course any other elements and changes that you would wish to make. And by then you may also know what the Local Government Association's response is. The only other comment we have, lesser impact, is that when looking at the best practice that's here, I think you accord to pretty much all of that, with one exception, which was about the commercial confidentiality of local authority companies. I'm not quite sure that the committee quite understood that relationship in many places between local authorities and
Mr. McCourt's last point, because in the Orkney government document, which appears for us on big letters 160 and 161 pages, it does talk about local enterprise partnerships, and it talks about ethical standards and corporate failure. So when I refer back to page 69, and it arises from the comments Mr. McCourt was making about best practice 14, I know we had a training session on aspects of the growth company. However, I want to discuss this issue about no further action at this juncture, which is the recommendation. We are asked in the recommendations to endorse recommendations, so I don't feel able to accept the idea of no further action. Now, if I suggest what I have in mind, members can talk to sheds, dreads, or whatever. What I've written down is that, in principle, given the increase in owned and jointly owned bodies, the minutes should be published as soon as practicable after each decision-making meeting. Officers prepare a list of bodies that could potentially have their minutes published and seek their views and report back for further consideration. So I'm not launching into straight away saying some of the bodies we demand you do this, but I'm trying to set up a principle that we would like them to do it, and we invite their views. And if they come back saying not on your belly, at least we can consider it. There might be some bodies that are quite happy to. But I don't have a list of all the bodies that might be caught by this. It'd probably be helpful if officers did draw a list that might be caught by it, so that you understand the implications of what I'm saying. Well, I got an idea of what I'm saying, but I want to see the extent of it and how it might work in practice, or whether I'm just going and charging off on some route of maximum suspicion unnecessarily. I'll turn my life an issue off.
Chair, my only comment is, as you say, some of it doesn't do any harm to ask those bodies to publish, will make the request to them, and for them to then say, well, these bits are confidential, those bits aren't, and obviously you may get a different response, whether it's a wholly owned body. It says here bodies, and bodies aren't always the same as companies, for example. So wholly owned body would include the mayor's charity, for example. Well, no reason why that wouldn't be, they wouldn't combine by it. Equally, a wholly owned company, such as all the evolutions, they say, well, we have things in commercial confidence, and therefore we wouldn't publish those elements. So you, just as you say, you get a different response, and then there are those, as it's fairly woolly thereabouts that they own or set up, there are many companies and bodies that the council has some ownership in, such as the Mersey Maritime. You are a member of a company limited by guarantee, and those companies of which the council is a minority shareholder is up to that board. And the other members of the board may well say no. Three separate organisations to do their bidding, but if the will of this group is to ask those bodies, or rather to make that recommendation to Cabinet that they ask those bodies to do that, so be it.
If members are clear, thank you, Mr. McCullough, for the advice. If members are clear on what I was moving, would you members find that acceptable?
All that, all of you, is having a
how many bodies or companies are we talking about?
There are a dozen or so companies which we know that the council has a shareholding of. There may be others hidden in the depths of time that are dormant, but in terms of active companies, there are three or four of which are companies limited by guarantee, what you think of as for charitable purposes. services, so the Mersey Maritime Group, that kind of things that you do alongside the Chamber of Commerce and other members on those bodies. There are two active trading companies trading in the marketplace, so Ed Central, which is jointly owned with Cheshire West, as you know, trading to schools, which is one of the organisations that will have very highly sensitive market information. World Evolutions, which is in the marketplace, and then about to join that game is the Rural Growth Company Partnership, which is its LLP, is a body of the company that will join that as a body that's active in the marketplace. And then the council has two charities of which it's a trustee.
I don't believe there's any problem with what those new we're going to ask. That's all we're going to do at this stage. Ask who says yes, who says no, who says what needs to happen on sensitive bits, what we're on the back, the confidential bits. But what I would like, following this, is if Mr. McCall's could provide a committee with a full list of these bodies that we're talking about. The committee where they have all this, the wholly owned, jointly owned, charity, whatever, that we all have that information. But I see no problem with the support of the bills and recommendations that ask cabinet to ask these bodies to provide that information. They say yes or no.
No, okay, so what we're asking for, put some additional recommendations in. So we're going to ask to come back to a future meeting, a list of separate bodies that the council have set up for which they own or party in.
Well, that can be emailed to the
You would like that?
I think that could be interesting.
You may find it helpful. I'm just thinking, as a committee, because you're talking about the actions of councillors on these bodies as well, officers as directors, and the ethics of that, you may actually find it useful to have that as a formal report.
Okay.
Okay, so we would like that to come back to us at a future meeting. Yeah, as a report, that would be helpful. I'd also like to ask that we ask for a report to come back on the councillor's code of conduct in the future as well. I know that we're kind of waiting on the LGA, but that piece of work, I'd be very interested to hear more on that piece of work that is being done at a Liverpool City Region level as well.
You've done that because you got off that slightly changed. I'm not sure if this would work, but it's possible. But even before we had the local city region, I recognise we had five local authorities, plus at that point, Mayor and Travel, at that point, the fire authority and the police authority. So, eight bodies, all within our standards committee. And I often wondered whether there could be a one standard committee made up of members of all those bodies. I'm not sure how it would work or whether it could work, but is it something we could actually look into?
So you're kind of thinking about the future?
A town basis of I don't know, it might be too cumbersome.
Has that been thought about, do you know?
It isn't uncommon for councils to have joint standards.
Yes.
Or rather, separation between, say, the constitution and overseeing side bits, and then actually when it comes to the standards panel and that sort of thing, shared. And particularly where there's a combined fire authority and stuff like that.
Yes.
Because then we can be sharing the independent member and their own processes.
Yeah.
It hasn't been as popular hearing his standards complaint, it's all being judged by the council from another authority, and that doesn't always sit well with the good purpose. But it's certainly something I'm happy to. Like I say, there's launching officers across the city region, which includes the fire authority, Mercy Chapel, and the police and crime commissioner's office. Then I'm happy to bring it up on the next agenda and see what appetite they think there may be from there.
Appreciate that, thank you. Phil?
Yes, when he was summing up the discussion and talking about getting the list, but I don't think you included it, the reason why we wanted the list and what it was for.
Oh, right. Okay.
I would have thought the list would complement request the cabinet for these bodies to provide us with minutes of their meeting.
Yes.
Okay, so we'll have that answered. First and foremost, we're asking for the list to be drawn up, aren't we? And then we're asking for the report to come back to us at a future date as well. Okay. So in addition to those two recommendations that we've already said, we've got, we're being asked on page 61 to make the report and the contents of the report in line with the two additional recommendations that we've made, and to endorse the actions contained in paragraph 3.6 in relation to best practice recommendations, taking into account any additional recommendations we've made, particularly around best practice point number 14. Is that okay? I'm happy with that. Do we need a move and a second of those? Yes, please. And can we have those? Thank you, Chris. And people are happy to agree with those four recommendations. Okay, thank you. So we've already done agenda item 7. So that brings us to the end of our agenda and meeting this evening. So just remains for me to say thank you to everybody for their contributions.
Thank you, Gerry.